And a guy who was a part of the DNC, in fact, during a roll call, it was Fred Guttenberg, who sadly lost his daughter, Jamie, who was killed in the Parkland shooting back in 2018. He's been an activist on gun control, which I applaud him. I think he's a hero when it comes to this. And he was a part of the roll call at the DNC the other night representing Florida. I want you to have a listen to this.
When my daughter was murdered in Parkland, Joe Biden called to share in our family's grief. I quickly learned about his decency and his civility, but I also learned about his toughness and how he's beaten the NRA. Together with the other victims of gun violence and our nation's youth, Joe Biden and Kamala Harris will take on the NRA again and win. Let's win back our freedom to live without fear. Florida cast 57 votes for Bernie Sanders and 192 votes for our next president, Joe Biden.
There you go. He is Fred Guttenberg, and he joins us right now on the line. Fred, thank you so much for being here. I know you're a very busy man. Appreciate your time. How are you?
Good, guys. We're doing all right. Actually, been quite a week.
I can imagine. You know. I can imagine. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, Fred, let me ask you this to start. Just your thoughts in general on the DNC. I thought there were a lot of really emotional moments. I thought Joe Biden did an excellent job last night in his speech. What were your thoughts on his speech last night?
My thoughts on number one, and I immediately went on social media and said this, I think that was the best political speech I've ever heard. And, you know, this morning I woke up trying to think about why he was able to deliver the speech that he did. And it's really actually a very simple answer. It's just that's who he is. You know, when I tell all the stories that I do about what took place between Joe Biden and I, when cameras were not rolling, mm-hmm. that's the guy you saw on that stage last night. The guy who was so open about telling me what I needed to know about getting through grief, about, what mission and purpose was, about what he has done and about how he believed his country was behind me going forward and to pursue, and to pursue what I wanted to, which was gun safety in this country. He had such a honest speech with me, a Joe Biden speech, because that's who he is. And that is the guy we saw on stage last night.
I believe you. I believe you 100%. Yep. Yep.
Yeah,
I hear you. So going on that, because I know you've also had at least one meeting privately with Donald Trump, can you compare the contrast and the empathy?
Because I've never met with Trump.
Oh, I thought you had. I thought you were in a room with him privately. Okay, I'm mistaken.
Well, no, invited.
And you didn't go.
The Parkland families were invited.
Gotcha.
Okay.
So.
Was for the rollout of the Betsy DeVos plan.
Gotcha.
Following the Parkland shooting, I refused to go because they refused to address the issue of guns.
They refused. That is sickening to me. You know, I hear a lot of stories like your story about Joe Biden's empathy. I'm sure you heard, and it's a different subject, but the stuttering issue. And then you had this 13-year-old kid yesterday, and I thought that was such a touching story. And I think the Democrats didn't they bring it home, Fred, what you're talking about? Joe Biden's empathy, the love story with him and Jill Biden, and the loss of his first wife and child, and then losing Beau a couple years ago. This man, sadly, has that in common with you, the grief process. I just think it's amazing, though, the way he thinks about others like yourself and what you lost.
Well, but that's, again, that's who he is. He does have that in his core. But what I think we also saw this week is he's a fighter. He's tough. And he loves this country. And all of that came through loud and clear. And I think what you also saw this week, think about what it took to put together this new style convention.
Right.
That's a true management and executive skill.
Yeah, it was tough.
And so everything about this week contrasted with what we're going to see next week. And I thought his themes of darkness versus light should be paid attention to, because that's the way things are going to look when you compare next week with this week.
Yeah, let's talk a little bit about that. I cannot even imagine, Fred, the frustration that you are going through, knowing not just your loss of your daughter, but the fact that there are so many Republicans out there that just refuse to pass any sort of comprehensive gun control, anything, whether it be red flag laws or getting rid of some of these guns off the streets. How frustrating is it from your standpoint? I can't even imagine that there's the Marco Rubios of the world, right? Those are the type of people who, by the way, yeah, well, he criticizes, let's talk about him for a second. He criticizes the Democratic National Convention for having celebrities. And I know you tweeted something at him, which was actually quite funny, and I liked your response. Can you talk a little bit about that? People like Marco Rubio, who criticize the DNC and do nothing when it comes to the, go ahead.
So he put out a tweet saying that this week was all about celebrities, forgetting the fact that President Trump is a celebrity.
Right.
That's how he got elected.
Right.
Okay. But as his constituent, who paid the ultimate price for his failure, who was part of the convention that he said only involved celebrities, I was pissed.
Right.
Okay? Because I am not a celebrity. I am not a politician. I am a person who lost his daughter because Senator Rubio and others have failed.
Right.
And so, listen, he's useless. He really is. And there's no chance he'll be able to win another term in this state. But that gets to the other part of what you're saying. Listen, there's a lot of Republicans out there who agree with me on gun safety. Currently, they don't serve in this particular Senate. Many of them are doing amazing work right now, the old guard Republicans, to help elect Joe Biden. And, you know, this current Republican Party that has completely embraced Trump needs to be broken. They need to be defeated so that a viable Republican Party can come back. But what is going to happen in this election is we are going to elect Joe Biden. We are going to flip the Senate. We are going to pass gun safety, and it is going to be bipartisan, because once you get McConnell out of there, Republicans will vote for it.
I have to ask you this, though, and by the way, I'm with you on all this stuff. Gun control, I am a supporter of Joe Biden. I will be voting for him. But with that said, as you know, Fred, there's no guarantee here, right? What if, and I know it's a big what if, but Fred, what if Donald Trump wins in November? Are we going to see it's a question that I'm asking Fred, because I think it's an important one. What if Donald Trump wins? I mean, will we see anything when it comes to gun control pass? Anything?
No, listen, let me be brutally candid. November 3rd, to me, it is all in. The consequences of a second term for Trump are gun safety is over, the conversation. And the courts will tilt further to the right. But the consequences are so much deeper, because I think you heard it loud and clear this week. Our democracy right now is on the line. It's on the line. Donald Trump cannot be sent back to the White House. Period, full stop. And Donald Trump is not preparing to win the presidency for a second term. He knows he can't win an election. What he is preparing to do is have a minority of voters believe that he did. And he is preparing to have that minority of voters take action. That's why next week is so consequential. If you look at who their speakers are, next week is going to be dark. They will already be blaming certain groups for the fact that Donald Trump didn't have the positive outcome.
Right.
Even though he quote unquote won. That's what they'll be doing next week. And they'll be getting people amped up and ready to react.
Mm-hmm.
So Donald Trump is not trying to win an election anymore. He's not taking any steps that would suggest to anybody he's trying to earn any vote, that he's trying to do anything other than solidify his base and hold them in line.
So a lot of conversation about defunding the police, obviously, the last 4 months, and it has caused people, I believe, to purchase more guns than ever. There's been more guns purchased nationwide the last 4 months than in the last, I believe, 20 years. I mean, almost twice as many as last year. Do you agree with defunding the police, and do you agree with the fact that people that are hearing that the police are going to be defunded are more likely to purchase weapons to defend themselves?
Well, I think those are two different, actually, questions. Number one, the increase in gun sales started because of coronavirus.
Right, that was the start of it, correct.
Yeah, so there's a much deeper, I mean, this administration unleashed a gun surge on this country. Mm-hmm. So I think that's separate. Now, as for the law enforcement, listen, I am not a defund law enforcement guy, and I don't think anybody running for office right now that I'm hearing, especially within the Biden camp, is either. There are a lot of people within the camp who talk about resources in addition for things like mental health. But no, I am not a defund law enforcement guy. Mm-hmm. I'm very thankful to have many members of law enforcement that I consider some of my best friends who were there for me when my daughter died. And you know, while it is true in any facet of life that there are some bad eggs, and that includes law enforcement.
Right.
Across this country, we should be thankful that they are there putting their lives on the line for us every single day.
Agree. I couldn't agree with you more.
As long as evil exists, I am going to count myself as a supporter of law enforcement and all of the first responders.
But you know, and to your point, and I totally agree with you, but if defunding the police does, because, I mean, it's happened in Seattle, it's happening in Minneapolis, it's happened in L.A., it's happened in, you know, New York City. If this gets more widespread, I think you're going to, if you do have gun control laws that are instituted, assuming that Joe Biden wins, I think that people are going to be much more reluctant to give up their guns.
Well, and that will make us less safe.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. I agree with you 100%. If you're just joining us, we're speaking with Fred Guttenberg. He is an American activist against gun violence. Sadly, he lost his daughter killed in the Parkland in 2018, and I have so much respect for him and his family. Hey, I want to ask you a little bit about Kamala Harris, Fred, if I may. Have you had any interaction with her? I think she's an extremely intelligent woman, very well-spoken. If at all, what have your interactions been with Kamala Harris about gun control just in general?
You know what? Listen, she is a firm supporter of doing things on gun safety. And I don't call it gun control, by the way, because it's not. We're not looking to control anybody's guns. It's gun safety. How do we make people safer from the risk of gun violence?
Right.
And Kamala Harris is a big supporter of things that I believe in terms of the steps required to reduce gun violence. She's been very active on the issue. My personal interactions with her have been somewhat limited, but we have had some chances to interact, and I think she's going to be a champion on this issue.
That's nice to hear. As you know, Fred, we had the worst shooting in American history right here in Las Vegas, sadly.
Yeah.
59 people. I know a girl who was shot in the back. Her life will never be the same, and, you know, she can't even work. And there are so many sad stories, like what took place, obviously, in Parkland. I don't want to compare, but two horrific tragedies. And then I think of this nut job, just like the nut that sadly killed your daughter, that are able to buy all these guns, all these weapons, and all this ammunition, mm-hmm. and I say to myself, what reasonable human being out there would say that we need to stop this from happening? We need to put, you know, red flag laws on the books. Do you know, Fred, and I'm sure you know this, if a husband threatens his wife's life and says he's going to kill her, in some states, if he gets arrested, when he gets out of jail, he's allowed to purchase a gun. What sane human being is okay with that? I just don't understand, Fred.
Well, so, but here's the answer to your question. Most Americans are not okay with it. The majority of Americans want to address these issues. The majority of Americans want to do something. The problem is you've had groups like the NRA who oppose anything, and they've used dollars to hold legislators and legislation hostage, even though the majority of Americans and the majority of gun owners want it. So here's the thing. When my daughter was killed, for me, the mission was break the effing gun lobby because they hold legislators and legislation hostage. And we are on our way. When Joe Biden is elected, they will not have a seat at the table. Mm. They just won't. Their voice has been the dominant voice on this issue now for too many years, and the result of that has been an increasing death rate in this country, and we're going to change that.
That is so important. So what I hear from some Republicans out there that might disagree, some Republicans will say, well, no, Democrats, they just want to take all your guns away. I hear that argument.
Then that's not true.
But I hear that argument a lot from the right.
But Kamala Harris, she is interested in a mandate where the government is required to purchase assault rifles in return for a credit. I mean, that is true.
I understand that, but that doesn't mean Democrats...
A buyback, yeah.
Right. But the idea that Democrats want to take all your guns away, it's just false, right, Fred? It's not true.
Listen, so that was one of those things when I started hearing these arguments after my daughter was killed, because unfortunately, I did not have my voice in this discussion before that. And I looked at people as like, are these really the arguments that this other side uses that have worked? Because no, it's not true. Okay? And I'll just give you an example. In Florida, we passed gun safety measures. We did. 3 weeks after my daughter was killed. Okay? In a conservative state, there's not a single legal lawful gun owner who pays any attention to the gun safety measures we have passed because they simply have no impact on them. All right? So nobody's looking to take anyone's guns away. It's a bogus, ridiculous argument. I do think we should be doing everything possible to keep guns and ammunition out of those who we can predict are going to be violent, or we receive word intent to be violent. You used an example earlier in this conversation, okay? We ought to have background checks. We should not let children buy guns. No, we do not need high capacity magazines or assault weapons. You know, we should have red flag laws. You know, things that absolutely will save lives. Right. This isn't rocket science.
Yeah, no, you're right.
And so we have a gun violence death rate in this country right now, 40,000 a year, and it's increasing.
Unbelievable.
That's not okay. Yeah. It's not.
Well, and speaking of one place with major gun violence is the city of Chicago. And as you know, Chicago has some of the strictest gun laws in the country. But, you know, crime, especially minority crime, is as high as it's ever been in the last 3 months. And obviously the pandemic has something to do with that. But the wrong people are getting guns in their hands, clearly. So if strict gun laws don't work, what do you think will work in Chicago?
Well, listen, so there's a lot of factors there. And number one, you know, Chicago has neighbors that have terrible gun laws.
Sure.
Who are a quick drive away. That's number one. Number two, the streets of Chicago have been flooded with weapons. And this is why I believe so strongly in dealing with ammunition. They've been flooded with weapons that are in the hands of people who would not be able to pass a background check. And those same people walk into the stores to buy the bullets because there's no background check required on bullets.
That's interesting.
Okay.
Yep.
If you want to see violence reduced in Chicago, let's have background checks on ammunition across this country too.
I think that's a valid point. I think that's a valid point. Yeah.
You know, there's so much more. Listen, my concern right now about gun violence, and not just in Chicago, okay, because people love to use Chicago as an example, but just not far from Chicago is Ohio, and you have Cincinnati. Okay, in a conservative state that has their highest gun violence death rate on record this year, and it's going up every single month. Okay, because what's happening is we're flooding these cities and these areas with weapons, and especially during times of coronavirus, you have more economic desperation, which is leading to more violence.
Right, right.
So people love to throw out these. Every time you talk about gun safety, what about Chicago? It's a bogus argument. You know, and so I just hope people, instead of continuing to do that, will agree with me. We need to lower the gun violence death rate and talk to me about how we do that.
I agree.
And there are ways.
I agree. That's a more important conversation. Fred, a couple more minutes here. I wanted to ask you, you have to have an opinion on this new NRA thing that's taking place in New York with the New York Attorney General pretty much trying to get rid of the entire organization, which, by the way, I wouldn't have a problem with. The NRA is responsible. They have blood on their hands. You know that we both agree on that. What do you make of what the New York Attorney General is doing? Are you surprised that it appears as though those at the top have been stealing from their members for years?
Well, no. So listen, number one, Letitia James is a hero. Number two, I have said now for 2.5 years, my daughter is nothing more than a cost of doing business for the NRA. They are a crime organization. They take money from their members. They don't use it in the way the members have thought they did. And it is not like it's been unknown for a while that those NRA officers have lived a good life off that organization. Mm-hmm. So, no, I'm not surprised. And what Letitia James is doing, this her action against them has nothing to do with politics.
Right.
It is a criminal action based upon crimes that they are committing with the money they receive from their members. And mm-hmm. you know what? They should be punished. They broke the law.
Fred, last question for you, and we're up against a break here, but I think it's an important one. For those people out there that are voting for Donald Trump, what would you say to them?
You know, listen, I would just say to them this. I hope you love this country as much as I do. I hope you believe in this democracy and Constitution as much as I do. I love your families, your children, and your kids. Everything I do is about them. I don't get mine back. Okay, I do not get my daughter back.
Right.
But I don't want to be the father that has to show up at a funeral for one of your children because we didn't do the right thing now. So please join me. You know, do put aside this amped up rhetoric. Understand the consequences of what is at stake November 3rd and join me. Let's make this country a better, safer place to be.
Fred, so well said. I have so much respect for you and your family, and I can't even imagine what you've had to go through the last couple of years. But what you are doing and what you have done over the course of the last few years, I know you would be making your daughter proud. And I really mean that. You have a huge heart, and I know how caring you are. And I hope next time, if you ever run into Brett Kavanaugh, I hope he does at least shake your hand. By the way, Fred, thank you so much for your time, my friend, and hopefully we can have you on again maybe before the elections. Thank you for your time, Fred. We really appreciate you.
Got
Thank
it.
You.
Be well, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Fred.